Coming up on episode 70 of the Upful Life Podcast.
So I grew up with that music in my house, Fats Domino, like I said, from the time I was a baby, and everything else, you know, it's like Lee Dorsey and I saw the Meters when I was 12 years old, always related to New Orleans music, Mardi Gras Indian music, brass band music, all that stuff. And it has there's a lot of its roots that are African roots, Caribbean roots. And there's a lot of things that we did in New Orleans, but the earlier generation, the earliest generations of R&B, rock and roll, blues musicians that Jamaicans were listening to and trying to imitate. And that's how reggae and ska came about, was them basically taking these New Orleans records and also, in all fairness, you know, records from Motown and Memphis and Miami and stuff like that, and listening to that and playing them at dances, but then trying to put their own spin on it, which ended up being ska. So for me, I always wanted to do something, you know, with reggae again. I just didn't know what. I didn't want to be like in this position as an old white guy trying to defend why I'm playing music that's kind of not really part of my culture or whatever. Well, I started realizing more and more, you know, it may not be part of my ancestral culture, but it is part of my personal culture and it's part of my personal background that I did this for many years and worked with lots of Jamaican musicians and toured all over the world with it. So that's a part of me. You know, whether you like it or not, it's a part of me. I'm not front, you know.
Indeedy. Welcome to the Upful Life Podcast. I'm your host, B Getz, and this is episode number 70, coming at you live and direct from the Vibe Junkie Studio in Oakland, California. From Oakland to Philly to back to Oakland, your boy's doing things. So grateful you are tuning in. The Upful Life Podcast is proudly sponsored by IMAVL, also known as Independent Arts and Music of Asheville. IMAVL has been preserving and promoting the creative community in Asheville, North Carolina since 2012, gradually watching Asheville become one of the hottest music scenes in the country. IMAVL does all they can do to support those making noise in Asheville and archive history in the making. With live stream installations in several area venues, IMAVL streams shows 6 nights a week, often several shows on any given night, making Asheville, North Carolina the very first city in the world with its music scene aggregated into one channel. Over 3,500 concerts in the archives, national to local acts, there's so much to explore. Not that long ago, IMAVL streamed 7 stages across 4 days straight for the first annual multi-venue AVL Fest. Based out of the world-class Echo Mountain Recording Studios, IMAVL produces an original series called The Echo Sessions. It's 6 seasons deep on PBS with artists from Eric Krasno to La Special, Billy Strings, Leftover Sam, and Marcus King, The Motet, and so many others. The streams are free to watch, a free service for the bands at each venue that IMAVL has production installed in. Now, IMAVL is a nonprofit and fans can donate to their efforts to support the arts by heading to their website, imavl.com, or you can scan a QR code on a recent show from the IMAVL archive. This organization is passionate about the city they live in and its amazing musical community. They've built such a community in a little valley in the mountains, and then IMAVL does what they can do to support their friends and family and share the magic of Asheville, North Carolina with the world. IMAVL.com. Don't stay home without it. Shout out to my man Josh Blake and the whole IMAVL team. We appreciate the support, the connection. Proud to be aligned with y'all. Up Full Life Podcast, episode 70. Yes, indeedy. Want to thank everybody for tuning in to episode 70, the Up for Life podcast. I know it's been a couple weeks overdue. I feel like I say that every two or three episodes, but this has been a crazy time for a lot of reasons. And first, I just want to acknowledge that what's going on in the world right now, particularly the Middle East and Israel, Palestine, etc., is really heavy. I've actually had to try to make this podcast and record these sections and during this week of intense conflict and death, emotional stuff. So I just wanted to take a moment in the beginning and just kind of acknowledge that, this is a really fucked up time, and everybody has a lot of deep-rooted feelings and convictions, and, you know, just wanted to honor that. I mean, this is not going to get into the issues. I'm not going to make anything about this pod colored by that energy other than to acknowledge its existence and maybe provide a program that can act as some kind of diversion or distraction or give somebody an opportunity to revel in their passions and culture and music and community and the narrative arc of an artist's journey, all the above. But I did not want to not acknowledge it because honestly, it's consumed my whole consciousness and attention since that festival was attacked, and that hits close to home, regardless of where you fall on why things are the way they are over there. Just, you know, I'm a festival guy, and that's my world and my universe and my community, and how I know so many people and how I move through life is so interwoven into festival culture. And to think of these people's last moments in the bliss of a psytrance festival and swiftly changes into a nightmare. So just going to take a moment and honor everybody who has been killed, who is being oppressed, who is involved in this conflict in any capacity through their family, through their own hearts, through their consciousness and convictions. Just pray for peace. Yes, indeedy. Dearly beloveds, we're back. And I know it's been a long time since I left you without a dope pod to step to. But I want to thank you for letting me be myself again. Thank you for tuning in. Thank you for supporting. Please, if you are digging this podcast, smash that subscribe button on your podcast platform of choice. And if you have the time and are so inclined, please rate and review the Upful Life podcast, preferably on Apple Podcasts, but really any platform you use to listen. It does a great deal to steer those algorithms in this direction and bring the Upful Life podcast new listeners, new ears, new souls. And that, my friends, is a beautiful thing. So thank you to everybody who has left a rating and review on the Upful Life podcast, Apple Podcasts, and elsewhere on the interwebs. You can reach me directly if you have any comments or feedback or suggestions, constructive criticisms, or you just want to holla at your boy. I love to hear from the people. Send me an email, b.getz@upfullife.com. You can also drop me a note about something you loved about a recent pod, and I'll enter you to win some Let Us Praise merch. Thanks to my man Joe W. out in Hawaii for the Let Us gear. So yeah, you can post a review on Apple Podcasts and screenshot that to me. Send me an email or just drop me a note via email, and I'll enter you in to win. Now, if you want to support all things Upful Life, I appreciate that. I'm in gratitude to anybody. So you can send me a few dollars for making you holla by going to upfullife.com. There's a support button there. You can send me a few bucks. It is much appreciated. I've been up to a whole lot since we last spoke at the end of August. Last minute trip to the mudpocalypse at Burning Man, which was a crazy time. I posted a bit about it on social. And I also wrote an article about Kruder and Dorfmeister's 30th anniversary U.S. tour, which began with their virgin sojourn to Black Rock City for Burning Man. So you can check that piece out on upfullife.com exclusively. And to my delight and eternal gratitude, Kruder and Dorfmeister shared the article on their official socials and called it brilliant and thanked me personally, which was just an incredible attaboy. So give thanks to Kruder and Dorfmeister. That's called To Weather the Rain, Dusty Dispatches from Kruder and Dorfmeister's 30th Anniversary U.S. Tour, Black Rock City to the Bay. It's a lengthy piece. I'm very proud of it. Thanks to everybody who checked it out already. Immediately after Burning Man, I went right to the Park City Song Summit for the second year. Mental health, music, culture, and community coalesce at Magical Park City Song Summit. That was on Live for Live Music. You can also find it on Upful Life. Shout out to Ben Anderson and IVPR and everybody who makes it happen for me out there in Park City. A very rewarding experience. Then I flew back to the Bay for Kruder and Dorfmeister's night with Thievery Corporation at the Midway SF. That's in the aforementioned article. I did a feature on Maria Stark, A Winding Journey to Weightless. Weightless is her new LP. It's her fifth solo album. Maria is a celestial, ethereal, magical empress, singer, songwriter, bard. And this is some really just translucent witch folk of the highest order. Maria Stark, A Winding Journey to Weightless. The Special released a new record called Odd Times, and my feature article on that record. The gains have been substantial. The Special releases fourth studio LP, Odd Times. You can find that on Live for Live Music and upfullife.com. And most recently, I did a feature on Judith Hill's triumphant Hometown Throwdown at Los Angeles Crossroads Festival. Live for Live Music and upfullife.com. I want to thank everybody who reads and listens and supports and gets behind all things Upful Life. These are crazy times in a lot of ways, and the community support and feedback is like a battery in my back to keep going. So I'm grateful for y'all. Thank you for tuning in. I want to say a few things about a dearly departed drummer before we get into episode 70. Main guest coming up in just a few. For those of you wondering, that was a new live mini set from Echt, our favorite Belgian trap jazz mavens out there in Brussels. 2023 Into the Great Wide Open, 20-minute live Echt performance. You can find it on their YouTube. I've got it in the show notes. Now here comes a little tribute. Take a moment and honor the life and times and legacy of renowned New Orleans drummer Russell Batiste Jr., who passed away on September 30 at the age of 57. Cause of death was a heart attack. Russell is one of the most influential and beloved and celebrated and pioneering drummers in the city of New Orleans history and drums in general. Unsung hero in some spaces, but king among men in the greatest musical city on earth. A partial list of bands that Russell Batiste Jr. played in include The Meters, Funky Meters, George Porter Jr. and the Runnin' Partners, Dumpster Funk, Bonorama, Papa Grows Funk, who you're hearing from right now, Soul, Second Line, one of Russell's originals with Papa Grows Funk. He also played with the Wild Magnolias, the Joe Crown Trio, Vita Blue with Paige McConnell and Oteil Burbridge, and his own orchestra from The Hood and Russell Batiste and Friends. I've seen Russell perform in numerous combinations, most recently Porter Batiste Stoltz PBS reunion show at Shaggy's New Orleans Crawfish Festival during Jazz Fest last year. The outpouring of grief and love and reverence for Russell was unbelievable and heart-filling and beautiful in so many ways. And the conversation I had with this episode's guest, Papa Molly, took place before Russell passed. And we talk about a different dearly departed brother of Malcolm's. But I wanted to take a moment and just celebrate and honor and eulogize Russell Batiste Jr. Now, I didn't know him personally. Like I said, I've seen him perform 24-ish times, not to mention a couple fist bumps here and there, a handshake. I've been introduced to him a time or two, but I didn't know him. But he seemed to know everybody in the music community, from fans to musicians to promoters. He was just a beloved fixture in his community in New Orleans and the music community at large. The tributes that came in the wake of his passing, one after the next, from all the iconic people from the city of New Orleans and peers and collaborators across the spectrum, you know. And I just, you know, wanted to take this opportunity to, you know, show love to somebody who was such an important contributor and teacher and student and innovator with drums. And there's so many different tributes and eulogies and reflections on social and articles and so forth. But I wanted to play something that I thought was very appropriate for this podcast, which is footage from a 2007 documentary where Russell Batiste and George Porter are sitting in Frenchie's gallery. Remember Frenchie, Randy Frechette? He was on the podcast a couple months ago. visionary, pioneering live art painter, amazing dude, friend of the pod, friend of mine now, I can say confidently. And there is a couple minutes from a 2007 documentary called King of Oak Street about Frenchie. And Russell has a few words, a couple minutes, about Frenchie. Again, this is Soul Second Line from Papa Grows Funk, one of Russell's original compositions. And now let's hear from Russell talking Frenchie before we get into episode 70 of the Upful Life podcast. I'm your host, B. Getz. We are lifting up the life and times of Russell Batiste Jr. Yes, indeedy.
Hello, world. It is I, Russell Batiste, funk master from Funky Meters, Vita Blues, the Batiste Brothers Band, Papa Grows Funk, Russell Batiste Orchestra from the Hood. You name them, I've been there. Tell y'all something y'all don't know. I've gave Frenchie his first brush solo at a Papa Grows Funk gig. It was supposed to be a drum solo. And what I did is I stood up and I pointed to Frenchie and I screamed on the mic, "You got it, Frenchie!" And Frenchie took a brush solo, which you just went totally mad and probably painted this one. Well, then see, it makes me feel good because, you know, when I'm playing and if I see Frenchie all of a sudden up there and he's going off, it's like, wow, I'm making him move. So it lets me know that I'm doing, you know, handling my end of the New Orleans tradition of making the music come to life. And all of the hottest bands that come out of New Orleans play at this club called the Maple Leaf here in New Orleans. And there's only one guy that goes into the Maple Leaf that they let in there with a canvas and paint and do his thing. And his name, ladies and gentlemen, Frenchie. Thank you. Frenchie is the only artist that we give a paint solo to. Like I take a drum solo, George take a bass solo. When I see Frenchie in the house, I say, "Break it down. We're gonna give Frenchie a solo." And I say, "Hit it, Frenchie." And then the next thing you know, you see Frenchie. And that's a Frenchie solo, invented by me, Russell Batiste. Let's do a scene like Prince. You ask me a question, I'm gonna tell George, and then George will tell you what I'm gonna ask. What I
famous photograph that's hidden underneath your bed. Honeybee, I believed you when you said twilight time was so much more than clouds and shadows turning blue and red. People come and people go, and everything will pass. But all the joy we used to know just fades away so fast. So if you see something,
it is my honor and privilege to welcome the great Papa Molly to episode 70 of the Upful Life podcast. And, you know, I don't know Malcolm personally previous to this conversation, but I feel like I know him real well now. He's a New Orleans singer and songwriter, guitarist, producer, multifaceted career, explored many areas of American and world music, big reggae guy. And he takes us through his journey, even pre-reggae, his childhood in music, his family, his journey as a troubadour, his sojourn through reggae music in Jamaica, back to the States. He makes roots rock, Americana, New Orleans style music, had seven walkers with Billy Kreutzmann and George Porter Jr. Now he's got this great project called Shantytown Underground in New Orleans, which is really deep throwback, like quintessential roots reggae mixed with, you know, New Orleans soul. And Yano is on keys in that group, and I loved them at Jazz Fest. And, you know, I've been paying attention to Papa Molly for several years now, so I figured carpe diem. I hit him up. He was interested in talking. Unfortunately, it was right after Brad Hauser, his friend and collaborator, bassist, had passed away suddenly. So we start the conversation with some touching and colorful and moving reflections about Brad Hauser. Before we even get into Malcolm, Papa Molly's musical and life journey. So it's a deep exercise in musicology. It's also a sense of eulogizing and mourning and also celebrating the life. And we're also celebrating Malcolm's life in the present tense. So Papa Molly on episode 70 of the Up Full Life podcast. It's a long and winding road that touches on many of the genres and influences and cultures dear to me, and I am certain it will translate similarly to you listeners. So thank you for tuning in. Here comes Papa Molly from New Orleans. With that, let's get into the conversation. All right, all right. Well, it is a long time in the making. I've been a big fan of this gentleman going back, you know, close to 20 years now. And it's an honor and a privilege to welcome the great Papa Molly to the Up Full Life podcast.
Hey, man. Nice to be here. Thanks for having me.
The feelings are mutual, my friend. I'm grateful that you made some time. I know you're a busy cat with a lot of irons in the fire, especially lately. So super stoked to talk about all your musical tentacles and your, you know, colorful journey through so many different scenes and generations and geography. But I really wanted to start on something a bit more solemn, but also beautiful. And that is the life and times of your dear friend, Brad Hauser, who transitioned yesterday. I read a very touching human reflection that you wrote for him. So if you're so inclined, please just talk a little bit about Brad, the guy, the player, your relationship, wherever you want to take it.
Very sad thing because it happened really suddenly, unexpectedly. I've just got our mutual friend, Rob Kidd, who's, you know, he's like my brother, really. I've traveled probably over 1,000,000 miles with him. And Rob called me. I guess it was, it was maybe Sunday or Monday, can't remember, but said that Brad had had a stroke and that he wasn't doing too well, but that we all, you know, everybody hoped that he would be able to recover and with therapy, hopefully be okay, you know. But then I got called the next day saying he had had another stroke and it was doing worse. I'm not sure the exact details, so I don't want to speculate. I do know this, that Brad was just a very sweet human being and a really amazing musician. And I played with him many, many times over the years and known him since the 80s. And it's just very sad to think about a world without him in it. And the music community, I'll say especially in Austin, you know, but really our musical relationship wasn't restricted to that. I worked with him on all over the country in many different places, including New Orleans here. And when I lived in Austin, you know, I worked with him a good bit there, but continued to work with him any chance I could after I moved here 12 years ago. I don't know what to say other than he was a good friend. He was a great human being and just one of the best musicians I've ever known and worked with, and very, very funny guy. I mean, he had kind of he could have this kind of thing where you would think he was cynical, but then you knew really that his heart was too big to be cynical. I think he was a little bit cynical about, things which he felt maybe you know, our government or people supporting people in our government weren't doing enough, or people just were too, you know, people in general, human beings just too damn stupid to do the right thing, which, you know, anyway, so maybe he was a little bit cynical about that kind of stuff, but for the stuff, matters of the heart, things that really mattered, he was 100% a pure, beautiful soul that, you know, you could feel the love coming from him at all times. I loved his sense of humor so much. It was very, he had a great wit about him. I spent a lot of time on the road with him, spent a lot of time, you know, in rehearsal rooms with him, on stage with him. Always had, you know, always had something great to add to the conversation, whether it was we were talking, whether we were joking, whether we were just hanging out and getting a bite to eat. But especially when we were on stage musically, his musical conversation was always interesting and always kept everybody on their toes, you know, because he was so good and so well, so realized as a musician. He just you never had to explain to him what the vibe we were, you know, like, oh, we're going after this vibe or whatever. He instinctively knew that. He was so well versed in so many different types of music that there was nothing that really seemed like it was a big challenge to him. He fit right in the groove, always added something extra to it. I'm gonna miss him a lot.
I don't doubt it, my friend. That was a beautiful reflection, and it really kind of helps you get a look at who the guy was in the van or at band practice outside of just the stage. Us as fans, we see the performances and hear the music. You know, seen Dead Kenny G's a few times, listened to the Critters record more times than I can count. One thing that I think of with Brad that I don't know that everybody knows, but if you put two and two together, is that, of course, he's responsible for the bass line on Edie Brickell's New Bohemian, What I Am, which is driven by that iconic bass line. The song
It
is
is.
motored by the bass line. And then Brand Nubian in the early 90s, major hip hop act out of New York City, made a song out of just the sample of the bass line.
Totally.
I'm sure you know, but it just reinvented the track for another generation, another culture. So, I mean, the man is responsible for like twice over iconic genre defining song, in addition to all the tentacles you just described and all the different projects he had a hand in. One thing I learned from your post was that the New Bohemians existed and brought Edie on. It was not the other way around, which I did not know that.
That is absolutely correct. In fact, the story goes that she was in the audience, and she was kind of too shy to get up and sing, and somebody bought her a shot of whiskey or something, and she got up the nerve to get up there and sing. And that was from that point on, I think she was in the band. So.
It's a great story. And yeah, he will be certainly missed. Yesterday, the last few days, I guess since Sunday, the outpouring of support, grief, you know, frustration, everybody who loved him, and it seemed like a lot of people,
yeah,
really, really hurting and grieving. And that's kind of why I wanted to start at the top there, because I wanted to honor that and him.
Yeah, he was, you know, I think one of the things when I was talking earlier about his humor and his, like I say, sometimes kind of a, he kind of sometimes spoke the words of somebody that was cynical, but you knew that he really wasn't. I think it was more like cosmic humor, cosmic irony. He was a very enlightened individual and very intelligent. And he, you know, therefore, when he saw ignorance, he called it out. But he did so in a way that was always really funny. Not like mean or superior sort of thing, you know, more like just funny.
Right on. Right on. Well, he'll still live on in our record players and our mind's eye, lots of videos. And like I said, it was just beautiful to see yourself and numerous other people just purge their feelings for Brad in fits of love or grief, or whatever. And it's heavy. We see a lot of that, like a lot of eulogizing going on as we get older. And I mean, you're a generation older than I am, but I'm 45. And it's just something that I'm encountering over and over again. And to see when somebody like yourself just takes the time to open their heart and share, whether it's on a podcast or on social media or even through song, we learn from those contributions. I just want, they're not in vain, or they're not just for you. I don't just learn facts. I have a greater understanding of who the man was through those reflections.
And I think I read some, I can't remember who posted it yesterday. I should probably have paid more attention, but somebody said something in effect that, like, he was one of those people that he had experienced fame and success in the music business and truly didn't give a fuck about that at all. It was the music, you know, it was like notoriety, success, fame didn't mean a thing to him. You know, being at a level where he was able to play with the caliber of musicians that he often played with, that meant something to him. And he was never, never, ever like giving you his B game. He was always giving you his A game, you know. You know how sometimes you hear people talk about, like, that's just all they do is they, you know, whether it's the guy that threw the touchdown pass in his high school football game, or, you know, the guy that, like, had one hit back in the day, and then that's all he talks about, and that pretty much defined who. Brad was not that person at all. He acknowledged the fact that, you know, that they had a really big success right out the gate with that record, but there was never a trace of bitterness or, like, regret or remorse or anything like that that I could pick up on.
I think that just speaks to the kind of guy that he likely was. And you referenced in your post about him, about the Deep Ellum Entertainment District in the 80s. And you have roots there. I know you also have deep roots in Louisiana and also internationally, Jamaica. So where does the because you weren't even Papa Molly yet, I'm sure. So where does Malcolm's journey start as a musician? Is it in childhood? Is it, you know, give us the kind of bricks of the foundation.
Like a lot of baby boomers, you know, I'm 66, just so you know, 66 years old. I was 5 years old when I got my first guitar. And the reason I got it was because I was just, as long as I can remember, I just was, like, obsessed with records and with, you know, people that were playing music on television and the radio and anything that, like, had guitar music in it. It just was I was crazy about it. I remember there was a kid in my neighborhood who was considerably older. He was, like, probably 12 or 13, and I was about 5 or 6. And he had this little garage band, and they were playing something by the Ventures. And I had heard my brother and my older sister playing a Ventures record. So, you know, walking past this garage in my neighborhood, I heard the song, you know, Walk, Don't Run, coming out of this garage. Immediately had to go investigate that. And him and his, you know, little teenage garage band were playing. But the other kids in the band, you know, like, we're like, oh, you know, get that kid out of here. But this one guy, you know, he's like, no, no, let him hang around, let him hang around. And then afterwards, he let me hold his Fender guitar and showed me how to play a couple of little licks, you know. And from that point on, I was just hooked. And so I just, you know, was bugging my mom 24/7, get me a guitar. So I think the very first guitar she got me was this thing that was made out of plastic, but it actually had steel strings on it, and it had a bridge, it had real tuners on it, so you could actually tune it up and make noise on it, but it did kind of look like a toy. And surprisingly enough, you know, I mean, as I think for my 7th birthday, my dad got me a real wooden guitar that he bought in Mexico that was actually a handmade guitar. He later told me that he only paid like about $25 for it, which at the time was like 300 pesos or something. You know, I remember seeing the tag on the guitar when he gave it to me that said 300. And I thought, wow, $300, that's a lot of money, you know. But I mean, even $25 in the 60s for a kid was a lot of money. So, but it had my initials carved on the headstock. I wish I still had that guitar. But that was the first real guitar I got. And then a couple of years later, I, you know, begged and pleaded until they got me a cheap electric guitar with a Sears Silvertone amplifier. And, you know, I never looked back. It was just always, it was like from a very, very young age, I knew exactly what I wanted to do. And I never even thought for a second that I had other options. That was it. It's in Shreveport, yeah. We're talking 60s. We're talking early. I was 7 years old I was 6 years old in 1963. So the Beatles hit in 1964, and that pretty much cemented the deal for me. And then after that, I remember a kid in my neighborhood who was also a little bit older. He said something like, yeah, the Beatles are okay, but the Rolling Stones are really better, you know. And of course, you know, I kind of, anybody that was a little bit older than me that knew something about music, I just believed them instinctively. Okay, well, I guess that's a fact then, you know. So I was never one of these people where it was like the Beatles or the Stones. They were both great as far as I was concerned, but the Stones did become my favorite though, very quickly.
I wanted to ask, because this always fascinates me, especially when we get to talk about reggae, but just in general, in the mid-60s, late-60s, when you are really hearing music as a young person for the first few times, how are you consuming it? Are you crowding around like a radio in the family room? Are you meeting up with buddies and a transistor radio out in the park? How did you like think and consume music?
Well, all of the above. My mother was a music freak too. She, you know, I still love a lot of the music that she loved, you know. She was turning me on to stuff like Roy Orbison and the early Elvis records. And she, you know, she also loved Louis Armstrong. She loved, so many great singers, you know, like, she was big in Frank Sinatra, and of course those records that he did with Count Basie and stuff, those were always playing in my house. Big, you know, influence on me. But then I had an older brother and sister that were also into music, and mostly the kind of my sister beat more, her and her girlfriends were more like into the top hits of the day, which in my case included like some of the early rock and roll records. I can remember hearing you know, like Bobby Charles, who I'm still just a huge fan of, hearing him, his version of See You Later, Alligator. And
see you later, alligator, after a while, crocodile. See you later, alligator, after a while, crocodile.
Hearing, you know, Fats Domino and all that stuff in my house when I was really, really, really young. Like, just some of my earliest memories are hearing records by Little Richard and Fats Domino and Chuck Berry and all that. So that had a big influence on me. Then my brother, 7 years older than me, he had really hip musical taste from as long as I could remember. You know, he had, and there was always records. Like, my sister had her own record player. My brother had his own record player. My mother had her own record player. And then I inherited a record player when I was still really young, too. Like, one of them got a better record player, so I got the old one. And so there was always records, buying records, going to the store to get records, looking, you know, reading the charts in the magazine so that I would know what was going on. And then television, you know, the Ed Sullivan Show had great acts on. There was a show called Shindig, which I've just started finding these old reruns of. They're amazing. You know, the Shindig House Band had, well, Billy Preston was the keyboard player in the Shindig House Band. Glenn Campbell and some of the other members of the Wrecking Crew were also in the band. And then they have these great guests on, you know. And so that was huge to me. I mean, I was like, I practically lived for it. It's like the only thing that I can really, really, really remember being super excited about. You know, knowing that my favorite group was going to be on Shindig or going to be on Hullabaloo or going to be on the Ed Sullivan Show. And I would just like wait until that moment and just be planted right in front of the TV with my eyes this big around, you know, just soaking it all up. I loved the Beach Boys. That was my first record that I ever bought was the Beach Boys Surfer Girl. When I was, it had just come out. I was 6 years old and that record had just come out and I bought it with my, saved up my allowance and bought the album Surfer Girl. And there was a song on that record, In My Room, which is a classic now, of course. But I remember my sister had just gone off to college, which meant that my brother got her bedroom and I got to have a bedroom by myself for the first time. And I remember bringing him that record and putting it on, and that song In My Room came on, and it was magical. It was like Brian Wilson had written it for me. There I was in my room listening to In My Room by.
There's a world where I can go and tell my secrets to. In my room. In my room. In my room.
Now a classic song, right? But at the time, it was the first time I'd ever heard it, and it was just, it transported me. It was, I realized that music could do that, could take you to another place, even at such a young age, even at 6 years old. I had this experience that was moving and spiritual, you know.
Wow, that, what a magical memory, just young you and feeling like, yeah, like Brian Wilson wrote In My Room for you in your brand new bedroom, your very first record. Yeah. I mean, that's pretty cosmic, let's be honest.
It was very cosmic and very proper. And I still have that same original copy of that record that I bought. I still have it.
Wow.
And I still listen to it and it still sounds great. I guess because I had older siblings, I always took pretty good care of my records, you know? So I can still listen to records that I bought when I was a kid.
Lucky you, because most people can't do that. Certainly not after the whole like DJ thing and scratching and stuff. But I'm lucky. Yeah. I have a bunch of records from my folks and I'll inherit some more at some point in time. And I do remember like we had like a piece of furniture that was the record player, huge, took up like most of the wall. And some of the records fit inside, and it was, you know, had like a wood finish and antiquated speaker. And that was really awesome. Like me and my grandparents and parents would sit around and listen to records. So I have a vague kind of connection to that, but it wasn't like my primary method of consuming music. What did jog my memory were the TV shows. Because when I was growing up, there were two shows I looked forward to. One was Yo! MTV Raps. The other one was Headbangers Ball. So you had to like make sure you got home for those, have the tape in the VCR. And so much of my understanding of the outside world came through those channels, for better or for worse. So I get that, like with my mom would talk about the American Bandstand, Ed Sullivan Show. So the lineage is totally there. And I was also thinking about how much you get inside songs when you're really young, when you have a limited amount to listen to, or your brain is just constantly developing and processing and understanding. And you listen to the foundation for modern contemporary pop music, rock and roll, et cetera. Like, what was your first sounds, from the Beach Boys to Fats Domino and Roy Orbison? And I mean, that is the bedrock of everything that's come afterwards, you know, in every direction. Yeah. So that's a really fortuitous and beautiful for you to have that sort of like a subconscious education in the greats of the of this art.
Well, I should also mention, you were asking, you know, what format was I listening to music in? I did, like I say, I bought records constantly. I saw the shows on TV, which I look forward to. But I'll never forget this, that I think when I was about either 7.5 or 8 years old, my dad bought me a transistor radio that had one of those little pocket transistor radios that has had a little earplug that you could, you know, plug into your ear. And it sounded terrible, but it was still a way that I could listen to music. Like if I was in the car with my parents, or if they thought that I was asleep in bed, I could listen to music. And so I remember that was when I first started feeling like this music is mine or something, you know what I mean? It's not something that I'm sharing with everybody. It's something that I'm listening to by myself. There was a black owned and operated station in Shreveport called KOKA. And at the time I had no idea how amazing it really was, but I did listen to it because it was just, you know, there was only like a couple of radio stations that I could pick up in Shreveport. One of them was the top 40 station, which was Keel, K-E-E-L, A-M. And then on the opposite end of the dial was K-O-K-A, which was the, you know, the black popular radio station. But the thing that really blew my mind was that once I started kind of staying up late, and my parents would think that I was asleep, or maybe they knew that I wasn't asleep. I don't know, but I thought they thought I was asleep. And I would, you know, get under the covers with a flashlight, read Mad Magazine and Marvel comic books, and I'd have my earplug plugged in, and I would tune into KOKA radio for the show at midnight called the B.B. Bird Brain Show. And the guy would play serious, like, blues and R&B. I mean, the show opened with James Brown's version of Night Train.
Tell me, night.
I'll never forget that. And then B.B. Birdbrain would talk over it. He was like, "This is the B.B. Birdbrain show. Play nothing but the blues from midnight until 4 a.m. It was just amazing. You know, it's the first place I ever heard Howlin' Wolf. And I remember I would just happen to be, my older sister's boyfriend had given me some of his old comic books from the 50s, which were included Tales from the Crypt, which had, you know, which were banned in the early 60s because they were too, they were just too freaky and, you know, bizarre for young people's minds, at least so the powers that be thought so. But I remember reading these Tales from the Crypt magazines, and then Howlin' Wolf song Evil came on in my little speaker, and I remember just like getting really scared. It's the sound of his voice was just like, for a little kid like me, it was just like terrifying, and yet I couldn't turn it off. It was like I had to keep listening to it, you know. It was just, had that huge of an impression on me. And then all day the next day I just kept thinking about it, you know, Howlin' Wolf. Oh my God, he must be like really scary.
Well, long away from home and can't sleep at all. You know another mule is kicking in your skull.
That's Evo.
Evo
is going on home. I am warning you, brother. You better watch your happy home.
Oh yeah, and then this is crazy too. Then the Rolling Stones had Howling Wolf as a guest on one of their television shows, and I think it was on Shindig. Actually, I think the Rolling Stones brought Howling Wolf on Shindig, and I finally got to actually see what he looked like, and went, well, he's not that scary looking.
When did you tell us something about him, Brian?
Well, when we first started playing together, we started playing because we wanted to play rhythm and blues, and Howling Wolf was one of our greatest idols, and it's a great pleasure to find being booked on this show tonight. It really is a pleasure.
Thanks for Howling, Jack.
So I think it's about time you shut up and we had Howling Wolf on stage.
Yeah, okay. Let's get him on. Howling Wolf, bring him on.
I thought he was going to look like a werewolf or something.
Yeah, that's the little kid comic book in you, dreaming it up, you know, under the covers. Yeah. I love that the scene. It's so clandestine. Parents think you're asleep. You got one earphone in. You got the other ear open to hear them coming.
That's exactly right.
Flashlight yeah. under the. I mean, it's amazing. Just the image of that, and again, it gives us a window into, you know, who. You are coming up as a young person, experiencing music, processing it, picking up the guitar, being just a hanger on at the band practice in town and getting a few licks. All those little pieces to the story, but it helps understand. I can liken it to like when I was a little kid and I wanted to surf with the big boys and they might let me paddle out with them a little bit. One of them might let me ride a board or two for a wave or two, but just being there, hanging out, seeing those guys make those turns, man, made like lifelong impression on me and gave me confidence to want to surf like that. So I totally get that. And I love the fact that you, and I'm like, tell me about the beginning. You really took me under the covers as a little boy. That's the beginning. Yeah. And I appreciate that.
Absolutely. And funny that you should mention surfing too, because even though I lived in a place that was totally landlocked, I fantasized about surfing, like, because that was kind of the popular culture of the early 60s was surfing, hot rods, monster movies, and rock and roll. You know, those were the four most important things in my life, and my dog, you know, and my friends and my family, you know, but probably in that order.
Yeah, well, having that Beach Boys record, I mean, how could you not dream about surfing between the waves?
Exactly.
And the girls. Totally. And that's actually, I think, what jogged the analogy for me was you referencing the Beach Boys and just thinking about surfing. But you've had so many musical lives and tentacles, and I don't know that I'll be able to touch on all of them, but I wanted to know, like, what was the, like, your debut, if you consider yourself, like, professionally. Obviously, you probably played in bands in high school and stuff, but when did your career as a performing artist, musician, songwriter, whatever form it took, what was that first project or era?
I mean, you know, I was trying to form bands as early as about 12 years old, and, you know, would get kids together in the neighborhood, and oftentimes they weren't quite the level that I was at yet, and yet I was still young enough where the older kids didn't really want to take a chance on me, you know what I mean? So I would basically play for anybody that would, like, listen to me, you know. I remember one time my cousin, who was older, about 7 or 8 years older than me, him and a bunch of his friends were sitting around, and he gave me like $1 to play for them. And I thought, wow, this is like, it was my first paying gig, basically, you know. I think I was 8 years old or something. So but then from that point on, you know, I'd always get in the talent shows and the play at the little dances at the YMCA. And then I remember, I guess when I was a freshman in high school or something, the senior that I knew, she had an actual gig at a club downtown and asked me to come play a song during her set. And I thought that was pretty special. And then I started going over to there was some blues clubs and some R&B clubs and stuff like that, where it was mostly black bands that were playing. I started trying to go hang over there. And some of the time they would just tell me to get lost in it. But there was one or two musicians that started seeing me hanging around a lot and said, oh, no, let the kid hang out and listen or whatever, you know? So that was always cool. Eventually I got to sit in with a few of those bands, and, you know, this is, I should mention that before that, though, I met this guy through my brother named John Campbell. Everybody called him Johnny Slim Campbell, but he was, I guess, about as close to a real deal sort of, blues revival kind of guy. I mean, he was a white guy, but he didn't come across, he came across like he had been studying blues his whole life or something. And I don't know how to describe it other than that. He pretty much lived the life. He was older than me, you know, he was about, I guess, probably 7 or 8 years older than me, but he is the first guy that recognized that I had some kind of honest talent and honest desire to learn this, older black music, R&B and blues. And I got it secondhand pretty much through bands like, you know, the Rolling Stones, the Yardbirds, the Animals, and then eventually like Jimi Hendrix and Led Zeppelin and stuff like that. The Allman Brothers, that was a big one for me. But when he first heard me playing, I had been playing along with those kind of records. And he said, oh, you should listen to the guys that they listen to. And that's when my repertoire got a little bit deeper, you know. That's when I started checking out. So he would loan me records by people like T-Bone Walker, and eventually people like Robert Johnson, Skip James, and Charlie Patton, things like that. So he taught me, he's the guy that taught me how to play bottleneck guitar and how to do the open tunings like the older blues guys did. So I was real grateful for him kind of taking me under his wing, being a mentor. And so then by the time I was, that was when I was about 13 or 14 that I met him. So by the time I was 16 or so, I was playing blues that sounded kind of credible. You know what I mean? Believe it or not, I've heard stupid little recordings that I did of myself back then. I got, damn, it's better than I remember, you know, but it's because of him. It's because of John Campbell. John Campbell was, to me, he was the real deal. He did make a couple of records for Elektra before he passed away at a pretty early age. And you can check his music out. It's really, you'll see what I'm talking about. It's pretty cool.
Yeah, I'll slide a little in right here.
Spare your head on me, baby. It's broken, it don't work anymore. Spare your head on me, baby. I said it's broken, it don't work anymore. I put your snakes and potions in the hallway, and the key you're holding, it don't fit my door.
So, yeah, I didn't mean to sell you short by saying after high school, because it sounds like you're already getting after it well into high school.
I was, yeah, for sure.
And
for sure.
You're also fortuitous in the two things that struck me. One is that you had a lot of autonomy for a young man as a teenager to go places and do things. Was that the norm in your community, or were you kind of, an anomaly, left to your own devices, have guitar, will travel?
I'll put it this way. My dad traveled a lot. Actually, you know, his job dictated that he had to drive around the country a lot. He was a sales representative for a national poultry company that would sell X amount of, you know, thousands and thousands and thousands of chickens and eggs and stuff to supermarket chains and grocery and restaurant chains and things like that. So his thing was, you know, this is way before the internet or anything. So basically, in order to have a relationship with people, he would drive around and meet them in, you know, in their little towns and their communities. And he would, when I was out of school, like during the summer or for holiday vacations or whatever, he would oftentimes take me with him, which I loved. I enjoyed very much. I loved being on the road with my dad. He was really, really, you know, fun to be with. And he taught me how to kind of respect the road. And I'm sure that's where I developed my wanderlust for, you know, and developed the not only the desire to be on the road as much as I have in my life, but, you know, the ability to kind of like know how to handle myself or take care of myself on the road, how to live and to be satisfied with that lot in life. As a kind of an example of what I'm talking about, when my dad was older, I'd say, you know, the last 10 years of his life or so, him and my mom were still together. But like, I guess a lot of older couples do, from what I've heard anyway, is that, you know, and they're, you get to be in your 70s or whatever, and maybe you don't share a bed anymore or whatever. That's kind of the thing that, so they, all the kids were out of the house. My dad basically set up his own bedroom, and my mother made her bedroom the way she'd always wanted it to be, which was so funny because my mother's bedroom was like a shrine to all the children. It was basically every baby photo, every award we ever won, you know, just covering every square inch of furniture in the walls, you know. And then my dad's room looked exactly like a motel room, exactly like a generic painting, a television on a little metal stand in the corner, even a suitcase, folding suitcase thing. You know, it's like, you know, nothing personal about it at all. Pretty hilarious. And but it kind of like was when I saw that and realized that for the first time, I thought, you know, is this how I'm going to end up one? I spent so much of my life in motel rooms. I don't think so, but I thought it was pretty funny that he did.
I mean, you became a really worldly guy, a really, really expansive taste that touch on lots of geographies and generations. And it's obvious you can trace that back to just your ability to just wander and seek. And it sounds like you've always been a seeker from the very earliest.
Like I told you, I can ramble on for hours.
And me too.
It's like
a
million stories, and they're and a few of them are kind of interesting.
Yeah, I find most of them to be, honestly, you know, yourself and others. And I just want to make clear, this podcast, one of the impetus or motivation for me to do this is to get these stories down on tape, sure, in the voices of those who lived them. Because as we remarked about Brad and numerous others, you know, tomorrow is not promised. And people are getting older and life happens and death happens. And I want to be somebody who can capture and, you know, basically chronicle the culture, but allow it to be done, prefer it to be done in the voices of, you know, I could write words, but why not hear the Papa Mollies and the Frenchies or whomever I'm talking to this week? Why not hear it from them? So if you are so called to pontificate for great length, to honor those pivotal experiences, humans who, you know, showed you the way, paved the way, rode shotgun with you, whatever it was. I mean, that's what we're here for. And we'll get what we get today and we can talk again, because I'm sure there's a lot of stuff we won't get to that after the fact, one or both of us will be like, oh, shit, we should have talked about that. So no worries about rambling. I really was curious about your beginnings, and you gave us a lot to chew on, to unpack. And one of the things, I'm going to kind of tie the past to the present now. One of the things that really drew me back into your kind of cauldron of music is Shantytown Underground, which is the new project you're doing in New Orleans, but really rooted in a former version of your professional and personal self 40 plus years ago, whatever it was, with the Killer Bees. So I want to hear, you know, as much or as little as you want to talk about the beginnings of you with reggae music, Jamaican culture, ska, and then being called back to it in New Orleans several decades later.
Yeah, it's, I'll try to be kind of to the point on this because that's a long story in itself. But in 1977, I took a random trip to Jamaica with my then wife, my first wife. I got married at a very young age, was 19, and we had a kid, and we were both kind of very young, idealistic hippies, you know, that had been, we had spent the last couple of years hitchhiking around the country, just taking in adventures and experiencing lots of things. And then we ended up in Little Rock, Arkansas, where her brother and his wife lived, and ended up settling there for a few years. But during this time, we were still very young. We had never really had any money to speak of. We'd always just kind of gotten by on our wits and whatever little cash we could scrounge up, you know. She got a job at a grocery store. I got a job working at a gardening nursery, a nursery, you know, plant nursery sort of thing. But I was also playing music, and I already started a band and was playing. And never stopped doing that. It was always the thing that I was doing. I just wasn't making a very good living at it yet. And we had a kid, so I got to figure out, better get a job. Anyway, she got her tax return from that job. And it was $800 that she got. And that was like the most money we'd ever seen at once, you know. So we decided we were just going to blow it. Just like, wasn't even really a decision. We were just like, holy shit, $800. Let's go have some fun. So the first thing we did is we went to our local neighborhood bar. And while we're in there, you know, celebrating, buying drinks, and there's this guy at the bar, and he hears us talking about, like, you know, well, what are we going to do with this money, right? He goes, you should just go to Jamaica. And we're like, oh, really? What's in Jamaica, you know? Well, I just got back from Jamaica, and it's really this magical island paradise. And so we're thinking, oh, that sounds pretty good, island paradise, you know? So without even really giving it much thought at all, we just bought tickets and went to Jamaica. And not knowing any better, we flew directly into Kingston, which at the time was having this political war going on. And this is in 1977. The two political parties, the People's National Party, the PNP, and the Jamaican Labor Party, the JLP, they were having such a bitter war that the entire city was just like under siege, like soldiers in jeeps, you know, rolling by, explosions, you know, less than a block away happening, buildings on fire. You know, it was crazy, right? So, and here we are, these two young, naive hippies with a baby in a backpack, you know, wandering around going, what have we gotten ourselves into? You know, oh my God, this is like, it's horrible. This is a terrible nightmare. But fortunately, we met this Jamaican businessman, you know, who was very nice and very kind and recognized that we were out of our element and needed help. And he took us over to the other side of the island. He was traveling over there anyway to do some business, and took us over there where we were able to find the paradise that we were looking for, basically camp out on this beautiful, in this coconut grove, which was right on the Caribbean Sea. This is near the town of Negril. And it was very, very, in those days, Negril was very much just like a little fishing village or something. A few European hippies, few American hippies, but mostly just like, you know, people that had grown up there. And the Rasta thing was like starting to become big, and reggae was like, you heard just everywhere you went, there was just like loud reggae music pumping out of these sound systems, you know. So had a big impression on me.
We're not the one, we're not the righteous one, we're living as a conscious one. God, not the awful one. Living here in Babylon. Stay down here in Babylon. So many of the wicked get strong. Down here in Babylon.
We stayed 3 weeks. We met some friends we met some people who became our friends, who were Rastafarians that lived up in the hills near where we were staying. And so they took us up to their place soon after we got there, and we started hanging out with them a lot. And they were, you know, showing us how to smoke weed out of these big bamboo pipes and called chalices. And, you know, listen, I had a little cheap guitar with me that, you know, they started showing me some reggae songs, and they'd play drums and I'd play guitar and play with reggae songs. Anyway, so, you know, we come back to America and felt like my whole mind had been blown and my whole realm of experience, you know, everything I thought about as a musician up to that point had changed. Suddenly I felt like reggae was like this new thing that was going to take over the world, you know? And I started trying to put together a reggae band, but it took me a couple of years to actually meet American musicians that were even open to the idea at all. You know, everybody just kind of like, what kind of music? What are you talking about? What, you know, that's the only sort of reference that we had at that point. I'm going to say this in the late 70s. Bob Marley had started to develop a following in the United States. He was much bigger in Europe. And, you know, but I knew who Bob Marley was even before I went to Jamaica. I knew who Jimmy Cliff was. I knew who Desmond Dekker was. Toots and the Maytals, maybe. That was it. That was about it.
How so? How did that music reach you? I'm just curious. How did that land in your ears?
Before I went to Jamaica, I found it very, I remember loving that song, The Israelites by Desmond Dekker. That was actually the very first reggae song I remember hearing. I guess that would have been about 67 or 68, something like that, when that came out. And it became a big worldwide hit.
Hey! Get up in the morning, stay begging for exercise, so that the every move can be. I said, I hit a head of a before me Israelites. My wife and my kids, she back up and I leave me. Not interested, I was used to receive. I said, I bore a boy with Israelites.
I remember thinking at the time how interesting and how different that sounded. And then, you know, soon after that, I think I heard, Johnny Nash, that was another one. He had a couple of hits, which were Bob Marley songs that he made hits of, you know, Stir It Up and Guava Jelly. And anyway, so I heard those and liked them. And I would always, you know, I've kind of thought of that as like, yeah, it's interesting. And then Paul Simon had the hit Mother and Child Reunion. I guess that was about 73 or 74, maybe. I don't remember, 72. So anyway, it was kind of on my radar, but it wasn't big on my radar. I'll put it that way. When I came back, 77, 78, I started like hearing some British bands like The Clash and The Police were, you know, they were touching reggae stuff. And that's kind of when I started putting it together in my head that, like, you know, this hasn't, like, reggae has a place in music that's happening now, you know, music that's like people are, you know, it didn't seem like something, a relic from the past to me at the time. It seemed like the next new cool thing, you know. So anyway, a couple of years go by and I put together this band called The Killer Bees. And I met this guy named Michael E. Johnson. I met a Jamaican guy named Cleveland Williams. And between those two, we had the nucleus of this band, which became The Killer Bees, which went on, you know, we were together almost 20 years. We went on to become, at one point, we were considered to be the number one reggae band in America. We were one of the first American bands ever invited to Reggae Sunsplash in Jamaica. And we toured with all the big reggae artists. And that's how I got my nickname. Papa Molly was touring with Burning Spear. And those guys started calling me that. And then other people started calling me that. And here we are 40 years later.
So yeah, let it be known, Winston Rodney, responsible for the moniker. I love that little nugget. What's behind the name?
It was actually Winston's drummer, okay. Nelson Miller, who he's the one who came up with it. But yeah, everybody was calling me that. So yeah.
And so Sunsplash was what, 83? If I'm remembering.
No, that was 87, 88. Either 87 or 88.
Okay.
At that point the band had. We had the number two reggae album in America. We had the number two reggae album on the charts, on the reggae charts. We were American, but we were the only American reggae band that was charting at all. All the other acts were, I think the reason, and people have told me at the time, I don't know if it's true or not, but people that were involved in the reggae journalists or whatever, they said that, yes, your album would have gone to number one if it hadn't been for Peter Tosh dying that week, which, you know, you know, I don't really, it's like, I just was bummed that Peter Tosh got killed. I wasn't cared about him knocking us off the number one position at all. I still don't even know if that's true, but that's what I was told anyway. But we did make it to number two on the charts, which was pretty cool. And Peter Tosh's album went to number one. That's what I was trying to say that same year.
Dread in Babylon. I love your old smoking. He love your friendship and sharing. He'd like the world to be sharing in love. Smoke it up in praises. Don't take it in phases. Laugh it to the fullest. In this world of the wisest.
We had a lot of success, you know. We worked really hard for it. We toured like almost 300 days a year the first 10 years we were together. We toured just nonstop. And that was, you know, seems like a couple of lifetimes ago. But, you know, you brought it up that I've had several different chapters in my musical career. And it's always amazing to me. I think the reason that that's possible is because, like I was saying earlier about, you know, Brad never, like, looking back with regret that they only had one hit or something like that. I can't, my mind doesn't work that way. I'm always on to the next thing. Even if I've just recorded a new record that I worked hard on and I love it, I'm not listening to that record once it's done. I'm on to the next thing. And people just have to tell me whether it's good or not. I don't know.
Well, you know, that's the nature of an artist. I noticed just the interview I did right before yours. We're talking about an album that's coming out on September 1st, and her whole mind was in the next project, even though we're talking about this project. So I get that. You're just on to the next. You're looking forward. But in essence, you did look back because you created a band that is rooted in a lot
right.
of those.
Oh, that's right.
So I wanted to just... First, just to kind of acknowledge.
I'm sorry, I got carried away there talking about
the
Killer Bees, but yeah.
I wanted to hear the Killer Bees stuff because that is the theme, is that, you know, you're coming back to, you know, reggae that really predates the Killer Bees because you're playing the really early formative stuff. But one sidebar is how lucky or fortuitous that you were able to like be adopted by some Rastas and taken out to the bush with your wife and child and just shown that, you know, I'm sure lots of Nyan Bingies sipping the chalice out in the bush and also getting a first person look at the war, the Siaga Manly thing you were talking about.
Yeah.
So much of reggae culture, the after effects of that conflict, songs, murders, political stuff, mm-hmm. and you on a whim flew right into the belly of the beast and were in essence like rescued by by a benevolent businessman and Rastas from the bush. That's a fucking crazy story.
Yeah, and to show you how naive I was, that first trip to Jamaica, I actually smuggled weed into Jamaica because I was afraid I wouldn't be able to find any there. So I smuggled weed into Jamaica, and thinking about that now, it's hilarious because like the very, you can't get out of the airport without people trying to sell you weed in Jamaica. At least that's the way I was with them.
Yeah. That's like bringing sand to the beach. I totally get it.
Yeah, exactly.
So then what was it in whenever 2020, 2021, that you decided that you were going to revisit, you know, reggae music for the first time? Don't worry, we're going to cover what happened in between a little bit, but I did want, because that's kind of what drew me really into wanting to talk to you, and also just my attention was the post you made about Shantytown. And then I went to two shows when I was in Jazz Fest. I went to the Lanyap stage, and then that same night I went out to Chickiwawa. And I love everything about Shantytown, most of all the musicology, like, or the instrumentation, the authentic, you know, full horns and really deep into like the authenticity of the reggae. So I wanted to know what was the spark that made you put that band together, and just tell us a little bit about Shantytown.
Okay, well, I think it's only appropriate that I also point out why I left reggae at a certain point.
Please.
Because when I first started playing reggae, I was young enough and idealistic enough to not even really see that maybe I was out of my realm a little bit. You know what I mean? Like a white guy from the suburbs, like playing this kind of music. It didn't even occur to me that I couldn't do that. In the same way that it didn't never occurred to me that I couldn't go sit in with, you know, blues artists on, you know, at black clubs when I was a teenager. You know, it's like, I know there was people who looked at me and just thought I was fucking out of my mind for doing that. But it didn't occur to me because I didn't see things that way. I didn't see music as being segregated. I didn't see they're like sort of, you know, the thing that's like certainly become, you know, a lot more people have become aware of is like cultural appropriation. And I'm certainly, you know, very sensitive to that now. But I think you have to realize the times back then, the fact that I was being accepted by Jamaican artists, I never questioned that I was doing anything wrong or that I was like, you know, ripping off somebody else's culture, which in essence, I never felt I was doing that. I never felt like, I felt like I was trying to learn from trying to like respect and appreciate this wonderful thing that was theirs. I always knew that it wasn't mine. I always knew that I was a visitor, a musical tourist, if you will. But I tried to look at it more like I was, you know, trying to get inside the music, respect it, to like do it as well as I possibly could. And the fact that some of the greatest reggae artists were telling me, yes, we accept you. You know, that was like all I needed. I didn't need the other people telling me whatever. So here's when I got out of reggae music was in the late 80s, things started to kind of shift a little bit. And by the mid 90s, they had shifted a lot. And I'm talking about trends in, well, you know, first of all, cocaine started flooding into Jamaica. They started getting even more weapons in Jamaica. And that became the culture, just like gangster rap became culture here. You know what I mean? The early days of hip hop, it was like, you know, that was like thing. And then suddenly everybody's got guns and Tupac's getting killed and Biggie's getting killed and everybody's getting shot. You know? So it was kind of the same way in Jamaica. And it was like, for me, that was never appealing to me, you know? People like, you know, crime and guns and hard drugs and that shit, never, you know, I got sucked into it because I was immersed in it. I did. I became addicted to cocaine and I found myself like hanging out with gangsters and seeing and doing some, you know, being not me doing crime so much, but witnessing crime amongst these people that I was working with a lot. It really, really, really got to me. And at some point I just kind of went, you know, now I really do see that I am truly out of my element here. I'm not cut out for this kind of stuff. You know, I'm not trying to pretend like I'm a gangster. I'm not a gangster, you know, but all these people that all these promoters and stuff that I was working with, they were moving tons of drugs and they were doing violent things that I couldn't deal with anymore. So I got out. Also coincided with about the same time that my partner for all those years, my musical partner, my business partner, Michael, and my best friend, Michael E. Johnson, also became terminally ill and died. So when he died, there was no question in my mind that the Killer Bees was done. We had gone through lots of band members at that point over the years. He and I were the only two original members left. There was really, you know, it was up to me whether I wanted to keep going with the band, and there was no question in my mind that I did not. So I left, but I never stopped listening to reggae. I never stopped loving it, especially the older stuff, you know, the stuff that really got me into it in the first place, the early rock steady stuff. And then there was always this thing in my mind too, that all the older Jamaican musicians always told me that they listened to New Orleans music. So, you know, I grew up listening to New Orleans music too. My grandparents and my mother is from New Orleans. So I grew up with that music in my house, Fats Domino, like I said, from the time I was a baby, and everything else, you know, it's like Lee Dorsey and I saw the Meters when I was 12 years old, always related to New Orleans music, Mardi Gras Indian music, brass band music, all that stuff. And it has its root. There's a lot of its roots that are African roots, Caribbean roots. And there's a lot of things that we did in New Orleans, not we, but the earlier generation, the earliest generations of R&B, rock and roll, blues musicians that Jamaicans were listening to and trying to imitate. And that's how reggae and ska came about, was them basically taking these New Orleans records and also, in all fairness, you know, records from Motown and Memphis and Miami and stuff like that, and listening to that and playing them at dances, but then trying to put their own spin on it, which ended up being ska. So for me, I always wanted to do something, you know, with reggae again. I just didn't know what. I didn't want to be in this position as an old white guy trying to defend why I'm playing music that's kind of not really part of my culture or whatever. Well, I started realizing more and more, you know, it may not be part of my, you know, my ancestral culture, but it is part of my personal culture and it's part of my personal background that I did this for many years and worked with lots of Jamaican musicians and toured all over the world with it. So that's a part of me. You know, whether you like it or not, it's a part of me. I'm not front, you know. I just thought, you know, how would I do this in a way that felt like it had integrity to me? You know, anybody else, they don't like what I'm doing, fuck them. I don't care. They don't have to listen to me, you know. I just got I'm my worst critic. I got to please myself, so. Mark Paradis from Johnny Sketch, he put on this little festival called Wild Things Festival, right? And he asked me, he said, would you consider doing a reggae set? And I flat out said, no, without even thinking about it. And I said, no, I don't do that anymore. And he said, okay, well, just think about it. I'm like, okay, but the answer is no. So then I started thinking about it. I started thinking, you know what? He's actually offered me enough of a budget where I could put together this thing and do it the way I've always wanted to do it, which was with a big horn section, you know, and then I went and saw my friends. I've been friends with the guys in the Iguanas for years, and they have a couple of them have a side project. Well, Joe Cabral has a side project called 007 with Jonathan Fralick, and they were doing rock steady stuff. And I thought, you know what, maybe I can recruit these guys and we can come up with something that would actually, you know, tick all the boxes for me. So that's how Shantytown Underground started. I know that's a long drawn out story, but it kind of, without telling the part about why I got out of reggae music, it doesn't really make sense as much as it does if I include that.
I don't find it to be long drawn out at all. If anything, I think that was a cliff note, but you did your best to kind of keep it focused, and I appreciate that. But at the same time, I love the rabbit holes. I love just your awareness, your sort of like understanding of the sensitivities, especially related to Rastafari, reggae, all the stuff we talked about, native to Jamaica, Africa, Garveyism. There's a lot of stuff there that's definitively African, Black, not ours. And you have been fortunate to be a guest in the culture, in the bands. I mean, you had dreadlocks for a long time and you don't anymore. I also wore dreads for about 10 years and I made it my mission to have an understanding about the culture. But what I realized, and you said it really well about being from the suburbs and just like a curious musician, like we weren't living, well, at least I'll speak for myself, I was not living like the sufferation that they sing of, or nor was my connection to creator in alignment with the Rastas, but I still felt a kinship to the music, to the energy. But you yourself, as somebody who sounds like you were living at the poverty line with a young family, struggling musician. So
I was.
So you do have.
By choice. I mean, by choice, really. I kind of like, you know, I wasn't like I was wasn't like I was born in the ghetto or something, which is a whole different story. You know, I realized that I was very fortunate and privileged in that regard. I've never not thought that.
Right.
And yet I did choose to be a musician that did have to, not if not suffer, at least starve for my art for a long time. You know, it's like I lived, you know, lots of places below the poverty line for a long time. But, you know, again, at any time, I probably could have gone and, you know, cut my hair and gotten a job that would have paid better or whatever, you know. But there was never thought in my mind that I was worried about not being successful in the music business. It just never crossed my mind that I wouldn't be, because all I really wanted to do is play music and make records. And as long as I can do that, I'm successful. I'm not, you know, judging my success by how many records I sell or whatever.
Totally. You know, and I get that 100%. But at the same time, it's just interesting to see how you view that, the prism through which you view that era now, all the years in the rear view, and then coming back to the music. I just have to say, I loved both Shantytown Underground shows. I really felt it was and I'm not an expert, but it was an authentic reflection of those like primordial recordings and influences, and the musicianship and the instrumentation was so real. I was thinking, I really love like Dean Frazier when he leads the band, you know, Firehouse Crew, whatever. And it sort of just took me to like that really amazing, full big band reggae thing that I don't know whether it's too expensive to bring that on tour, but so many reggae artists are using synths for their horns. And, you know, I know that goes back to the 80s and everything, but it's rare that you get a full big band, all the colors, all the sounds, and the songbook being, you know, like the classics. So I just wanted to give you props and say how much I love that. And I'm so glad that Mark asked you to make that band for that night, because obviously I didn't see that show. So you've been continuing to perform with this group. Do you think that that's going to be something that you'll go back to regularly, or is this just?
I do. Yeah. I think that you kind of mentioned something about, you know, the realities of taking a show that big on the road or something. I personally spent so many years of my life touring on the road that I made a personal decision several years ago that I don't want to tour unless there's actually a real market for it. And like, in other words, if for some reason I have some record that gets, you know, crazy popular and I can afford to tour the way I want to, then yeah, I'll go on tour. But to just do it like I used to do it, we're just like, you know, buy a used van and a trailer and me and the guys load it up and go drive all over the country for, you know, gone for months at a time. I'm not doing that ever again. I had my days of doing that and they were fun, and I would not have a national profile if I hadn't have been willing to do that kind of stuff. But then, you know, like you said, I've had several chapters to my career. The Seven Walkers chapter was a huge surprise to me, because that actually was a time much late, you know, very late in my life, where I did get to actually have those sort of amenities like 5-star hotels, tour buses, you know, roadies, drivers, tour managers, all that kind of stuff. That was kind of showed me, okay, this is how you're supposed to tour.
Totally.
You know, this is how people my age are supposed to tour, at least. Anyway, they're not supposed to have to. I know guys my age that still do that. That still, you know, own the van and load their own gear and all this stuff. And I'm done with that. But the Shantytown Underground thing, though, it's out there. Now people are beginning to realize that it's out there. And we are available for hire. We'll play your festival. We'll play your town. We'll play your club. But you got to be willing to pay for it. You know, it's a 10-piece band. I'm not going to just take us out there and everybody come home broke. So, you know, just you want that. We'll be happy to give it to you and hopefully provide a quality product and something that your people will like. But we're not going to do it cheap.
I actually was going to ask about Seven Walkers later, but I'll get into that right now, because I can't think that's probably what really brought me into you into focus for me. I remember actually the first time that I actually really saw you perform or took notice of the who you were in this community was you sat next to me in the chapel at Bear Creek when like they did that Nigel Hall wedding on one year.
You were next to me
in the chapel, and then I saw you perform a couple times that weekend, and I've basically been a fan of yours ever since. That's about 15 years ago now, and
yeah,
a lot has transpired, but shortly after that, 2 or 3 years is when Seven Walkers came to fruition. So as a lifelong Deadhead, I always love to see the different formations and evolutions of the Grateful Dead songbook, of the ethos, and then having guys like George and yourself playing with Billy. Of course, Matt was great. How does that come together? Like, how does that band take shape? And also, please, if you wouldn't mind, touch on what was it like writing with Hunter?
Yeah, okay. I'll answer one at a time, because it was like, the way it happened was so random. And so just like, you know, it was like fate intervened, I guess, you know. But I was playing with my band, Papa Molly Trio, at the Oregon Country Fair. It was my first time to play Oregon Country Fair. And a lot of my friends had been telling me about the history of the Oregon Country Fair, that, you know, it was kind of an important place in the history of the Grateful Dead, and that we might be likely to still, you know, run into, you know, Zane Kesey or Mountain Girl or somebody living up there, right? And I'd been a Grateful Dead fan when I was much younger, and I'd say from the early 70s up until like maybe the mid 80s, I was aware of pretty much everything the Dead did. I bought their LPs, although I didn't follow them around from town to town. I didn't trade tapes with other fans. I was not a Deadhead, in other words. I was not, you know, I loved the Dead during that time especially, but I loved lots of bands. I loved, you know, I loved Bob Dylan. I loved Curtis Mayfield. I loved all kinds of music. And then I was also getting into reggae during kind of the later period that I speak of. So that kind of took over everything for a while. Always loved soul music and funk and all that stuff too, blues. So while the Dead were important to me in that regard, they weren't like as important, for instance, as like Muddy Waters was to me, or even James Brown or what, from, you know, but they were definitely on my radar, and especially those earlier records. Like, you know, I loved the Europe 72 record was always my favorite record. I'm not sure why, but, oh, and Working Man's Dead and American Beauty, that era really, really, you know, that's the one that I think when I got deepest into the Dead at a younger age. So then I'm backstage after my set at Oregon Country Fair. Fast forward, God knows how many years. This is probably 2008, maybe 2008, I think. I just finished my set, Oregon Country Fair. Billy comes walking up to me. I didn't recognize him at all. He just seemed like this nice guy. We were talking. He said he enjoyed my set. He mentioned that he was a drummer. We started talking about New Orleans. We were talking about fishing, all these things. We were just really seemed to be hitting it off, you know, and I didn't recognize him at all. Suddenly I noticed there's a group of people gathering around us, just wanting to listen to our conversation, which just doesn't happen to me very often. It probably happens to him all the time. But so I'm starting to think, why are these people like crowding around us? And then I noticed on his hat, he had a little steely on his cowboy hat. And suddenly I remembered he had introduced himself as Bill. And I put two and two together. I said, wait a minute. I said, are you Bill Kreutzmann? He goes, well, yeah, actually it's Kreutzmann, but yeah. And then after that, that ended up being kind of a crazy, magical day. He doesn't care if I talk about this stuff. So you can cut this out if you want to, but I'm I think it's pretty interesting is that I'd say within about 30 minutes after us meeting each other, he goes, you want to drop some acid? And I was like, at that point, it had probably been close to 20 years since I dropped acid. I still did mushrooms about two or three times a year, maybe. But, you know, most of the acid that I got, especially during like the 80s and shit, was just terrible, you know? So I quit doing acid because I never knew what I was going to get. I was like, didn't want that speed kind of stuff or strychnine or any of that stuff. So Bill said, you want to drop some acid? I looked at him, I was kind of like, in my mind, I'm thinking, you know, if I'm ever going to drop acid again, now's probably the time I should do it. And before I could even say anything, he goes, trust me, man, this is like the best shit you've ever done or the best shit you ever will do. Okay, let's do it. So off we went for like, really the next 3 days, we just hung out together out there in the woods at Oregon Country Fair. And we tripped and we played music and we just hit it off great. And then Monday morning when it was all over, you know, we swapped phone numbers, but I kind of thought, well, I probably won't hear from him again, you know. But within a day or so, he called me up and invited me to come to Hawaii, which, of course, I did. And then
hit a slam. You come without no warning. In this land.
We ended up playing some gigs together, and then he introduced me to Hunter, and then Hunter and I started writing together, which was incredible. And that's a whole different story there. That's because that's a whole different psycho. It's like Hunter, it felt like something kind of like some sort of sacred trust that I had been entrusted with, you know, that I had to, I took it very seriously, you know, and wanted to just do my very best. And there's still about, I'd say, a dozen songs that Hunter and I started and didn't really finish, or at least we didn't record. And I was wondering why, you know, one of the things that made me the saddest about when he passed away a few years back is that we still had this work in progress that I felt like, well, there was at least a few of the songs that he did sign off on. So I have since, you know, stayed in touch with his widow, Maureen, and with his publisher, Alan, who ran,
Ice Nine.
Thank you. So anyway, I have the blessing to finish those songs and release them at some point, which I fully intend to do. It's when the time is right. Soon, probably pretty soon. I'm not getting any younger either, you know, but, anyway, an amazing experience. It felt like I remember when Hunter sent me the first set of lyrics, which was King Cotton Blues. I remember just like staring at the page for almost 3 hours, just hoping that something would come to me. And it did. It was just like amazing. It was like, once the words all kind of crystallized in my mind and I put the story together and I put the character together that inhabits that story, the music started coming to me. And then I invited Matt Hubbard over the next day, and Matt and I worked out some chord changes. He came up with some very significant contributions as well.
It ain't because of courage on account of being brave. I never saw much reason to avoid an early grave. Thank you.
I realized that the nature of the song, you know, it reminded me of like a couple of other classic Hunter Garcia songs, like Loser and like, you know, Candyman, things like that. A few others had that kind of timeless sort of vibe. Like it, maybe it's the old West. Maybe it's like, you know, the 30s. You can't really tell, you know what I mean? And that was actually one of the first questions once I realized that I could talk to Robert about this stuff and that we were actually collaborating on something and that he wanted my input. You know, it was one of the first questions I asked him. I said, you know, so much of your stuff seems so timeless. And I think that that's a very appealing aspect of your catalog, is that you can, it's really hard to pinpoint exactly when the timeline on these songs is, you know. And he said, oh yeah, that's very much by design, you know. He said, I don't know if he really felt this way, but he said, one of my big regrets was the line in Mississippi Half Step where it says, the cue ball is made of styrofoam. I said, once that was recorded and released, I really regretted having used that image because styrofoam pinpoints it to a certain era. And I said, really? I never even thought about that before. He goes, yeah, well, think about it. He goes, you know that didn't happen before they invented styrofoam, right? I was like, yeah. It's pretty ingenious, really, but that was the way his mind worked, you know?
Yeah, that's interesting to hear on so many levels, especially like, well, Half Step's like early 70s. So that's like, styrofoam was like revolutionary product probably at the time. And yeah. Now seems this like antiquated sort of anachronism that is useless, you know? And
yeah.
So it almost, backwards, it becomes timeless again. But nonetheless, I love the magical fairy tale town where Hunter's song takes place, you know.
Me too.
So what I was going to say is you slid right in there.
An area.
A really incredible chapter of your career and, of course, you know, just continuing this the lineage of you know, the Grateful Dead thing, obviously beyond the band itself. And of course, the New Orleans connection with George Porter Jr. And I knew you... You mentioned you moved to New Orleans a dozen years ago. So that was, I guess, after Seven Walkers, you moved to New Orleans, or in the midst of that? And
Seven Walkers was still together when I moved to New Orleans. And it's, again, it's a move that I've been planning for so many years. And just, you know, life has things in store for you that you don't know. Like, I raised a family. And, you know, my wife and I met in New Orleans in 1982. We got married in New Orleans in 1984. We moved to Austin because the Killer Bees had a manager that lived in Austin in about 85. Now, I know for a fact I didn't plan on staying in Austin as long as I did, but you know, you start having kids and they're getting schools and your wife has a job and it's a good job. And I'm on the road traveling all the time anyway, so it doesn't seem to really matter where I live. But my intention was always to end up back in New Orleans. So eventually, when the kids had finished high school and were grown, then there was no reason really for us not to anymore. So I just kind of insisted on it, and we did. That's the bottom line right there. A couple of my grown kids had already moved here years earlier to New Orleans, and so I was already coming to New Orleans a lot and staying with them and seeing them and, you know, working here, playing music here, developing friendships that are lifelong friendships. So a lot of people thought I lived in New Orleans way before I actually did move back to New Orleans. So I never went around telling people I did, but people assumed that because of the music that I play and because of my background and all that. But yeah, so finally, when I finally got back here, things felt like they had kind of like started to kind of all make sense again. You know, not to say that I didn't love Austin too. Austin was a great place when I moved there in 85, an amazing place to live. So musician friendly and so cheap, and like everything like revolved around music, and like it was so great, you know. So that was, I love, have some wonderful friendships that I still, you know, maintain in Austin, and still love my Austin people. You know, I need to get back. I haven't played there since before the pandemic. I need to get back.
Well, hopefully you can make that happen in the not too distant future. And I love, you know, what you've been up to while you were in New Orleans, the people you play with, the projects. So I wanted to just kind of hang out there for a little bit. I got a lot more questions, but let's go with two more. One New Orleans relevant and one maybe a way back machine one more time. So you move there and you kind of been doing Papa Molly thing. Obviously you mentioned Shantytown Underground, but that's relatively new. You know, I was doing a cursory kind of getting reacquainted with your catalog, and I was listening to a record you made in 2015. And I really love Make a Way.
Oh, thank you.
So I was curious, first of all, tell me about the Cherokee Medicine Man, and also just making that, okay, because it sounds like that is your project with your name on it after you moved to the city of New Orleans. I think you can definitely hear that in the music. So tell me a little bit about that project. And yeah, I got to know about it. It's Reverend Goat Carson.
Yeah, Reverend Goat Carson is somebody that I met. I met him through my friend Cyril Neville, who I've known since the 80s. He actually helped put the Killer Bees on the map when he recorded with us back in 1984, I believe. So we've been friends for years, and the whole Neville family. And then I was doing some work with Cyril and with Big Chief Monk Boudreau, and they introduced me to Reverend Goat Carson, who was he grew up in Oklahoma as Cherokee. His came from I think his grandfather had been a medicine man, and he had that same gift, you know, where he just had kind of those, you know, he did things that were hard to explain. I'll put it that way. You can believe whatever you want to believe, but he would do, he had a way of sort of knowing things that he couldn't have possibly known if he wasn't in touch with some sort of metaphysical vibration on some level. I mean, I'll put it that way. The most memorable story I have about him in that regard, although there are many, many examples, but the most memorable one was that I was in Montana with my band, and it was snow and ice on the ground. And I stepped out of the van and had a guitar case in each hand and stepped onto a patch of black ice. My feet went out from under me, hit my head on the pavement on the ice, and was knocked unconscious, got a concussion, was knocked completely unconscious. Well, while I was unconscious, I had this vision of the Reverend Goat coming to me and kind of doing this like Native American sort of dance and chanting. And when I woke up, when I came out of this, you know, being knocked out, I was on my motel bed, and Rob Kidd, my dear friend and drummer, was there, and he was kind of like, oh shit, he's awake. And a couple of other people were standing around like, because we were up in the mountains, and they were wondering whether or not to call what do you call the helicopters, the vac, that'll come and get you, because
medevac.
Yeah, thank you, medevac, that's right. They're trying to determine whether to call one of those from a bigger city to fly in and get me, because the roads were icy and there was like no ambulances and no hospitals or whatever. So when I woke up, everybody seemed like, oh, well, you seem okay. You feel okay? I was like, you know, a little fuzzy, but I'm okay, I guess, you know. And we did a couple of like little random tests and stuff, and it looked like I passed them, I guess. So we decided not to call the emergency crew. But I looked while they were sitting there, like, you know, checking my pupils and stuff, I could hear my phone just kind of like blowing up, like just like one after one, you know, one time after, you know, just ringing over and over and over and over. So finally I said, let me see who this is, you know? I looked at it, and it was Goat. It was Reverend Goat. It was about 15 missed calls from him. And the first thing he says to me is like, "How'd you like my dance?" Yeah, he said, I'm glad you picked up. I was worried about you. How'd you like my dance?" So that was that was kind of typical. It was kind of stuff that would happen around Goat Carson.
So you made that record. What was the title of that album?
Music is Love.
Music is Love. It's so well stated. And that's a very New Orleans Papa Molly project. I know you played out recently. You were shedding a band for a couple gigs this week. So I was curious, what do we hear songs from that page in your songbook?
Yeah.
When you do that, do you kind of touch on all the chapters? We play something from 30, 40 years ago you wrote in 2023?
Yeah, I mean, I do. When I do Papa Molly shows, I kind of tend to stick to the music that I recorded as Papa Molly and under my own name, and not, like, for instance, I don't do reggae music on the Papa Molly show. Maybe every once in a while, if it's the right person asks me nicely, I might do a reggae song or something, but I save that for Shantytown Underground, and then I also do, you know, I also have this funk project that I've been doing called Brand New Bag, which is, that's just kind of mostly kind of rare covers and some more not so rare covers, like doing little James Brown stuff and doing some kind of rare New Orleans funk records, that sort of thing, just trying to recreate those as faithfully as possible. But that was also created kind of as a vehicle for guest singers too, you know. Shantytown Underground is kind of a vehicle for guest singers too. We just haven't found that many people that I'm really hoping that I'm trying to visualize this so that, you know, I can manifest it. And if anybody's out there listening right now and you happen to be a great reggae singer, you can be male, female, black, white. You can be from Jamaica. You can be from America. But if you really are a great reggae singer, hit me up. Maybe you can do a guest spot with Shantytown Underground, because I'm looking for people like that.
All right. Well, you heard it here first. We'll put out the SOS for Shantytown Underground. And yeah, man, it's just it's great to hear all the different, you know, irons in the fire, as I like to say. And we left more on the table than we covered. So I obviously would love to talk again down the road, and we can take some different paths traveled. But I'd be remiss, in the event we only talk one time, I would be remiss if I didn't ask about the Fog City era, because I feel like that is so seminal for so much of the music that thrives at Jazz Fest or a Bear Creek or whatever. Was the stuff that Dan Prothero was behind, Fog City Records. He made Records of Galactic. You made two albums with Dan, if I'm correct, right?
Yeah. Two albums on Fog City, and I couldn't agree with you more. That was like, for me, that was like getting a, you know, whereas, you know, Seven Walkers might have been like the third really major chapter in my musical career. Fog City was like really the second major chapter in my musical career, because it was as the Killer Bees were on our way out. You know, my friend, as I mentioned, had become terminally ill, and we kept the band together for another couple of years while he was alive, for no other reason, just to help pay his medical bills. And, you know, he didn't have any other source of income. So I'd say the last couple of years we were together, a lot of that was just us trying to keep Michael, you know, in financial, you know, straits, to kind of help his situation out. And, But I was already working on the Fog City music at that point, and I'd already gotten this deal with Dan Prothero. So yeah, without a doubt, that helped give me some sort of national profile and credibility in a scene that I was not that familiar with, which was the, for lack of a better word, the jam band scene. I, you know, working for almost 20 years in a reggae band, we really didn't see much of that. We weren't invited to the, you know, the Bonnaroo festivals and that sort of thing. But as soon as I came out with this record on Fog City, suddenly those doors were open to me. And I was doing all these festivals and playing with, you know, all these different jam bands and stuff. And which I fit right into, really. I mean, because that the nature of my music has always been improvisational. I don't know. It was very, very fortuitous for me to meet Dan Prothero and for him to want to record me back. That album, that first album, Thunder Chicken, came out in 1999.
When you see me dance, I ain't no fool. I took an old Creole, never been to school. You wanna get along in a Creole town?
I'd say it really did set the tone. 15 years or so of my life was like playing these festivals and getting to be friends with people like Widespread Panic and Fish. And I guess that's really how I ended up meeting Billy too, you know, was the, eventually I gained a reputation in that world. And he told me that the reason he was at my show that day was because his girlfriend at the time, now his wife, Amy, she had one of my CDs. And he liked it and wanted to come see my show. So that's how we ended up meeting. So, yeah, Dan Prothero, Fog City Records, had a major, major impact. And honestly, I still am very proud of those records, too. Thunder Chicken and Do Your Thing. Do Your Thing especially, I think it really holds up really well.
Honey, be you are always in my head, like that famous photograph that's hidden underneath your bed. Honeybee, I believe you when you say.
And I love that recollection right there with regard to like Fog City putting you on the map and then the doors flying open. And that's what I heard first when, after I sat next to you in the chapel, saw you at Bear Creek, when I looked you up.
Mm-hmm.
Those are the projects, the Thunder Chicken and Do Your Thing, and kind of then just followed wherever you went from there. And I think you can kind of trace probably the M&M's thing, the brand new bag, back to that.
Sure.
Right?
Sure.
It all kind of springs out of that. I was curious, because I know you produced records.
Uh-huh.
Other artists, did you learn under the tutelage of Dan, or does that predate Fox?
Well, I had already produced some reggae stuff and some soul stuff before that, but Dan's production value absolutely made me, I learned a lot working with him. I'll put it that way. I learned a lot. And there was, and a few other people too, but especially Dan. Dan taught me something that I'll never, ever forget. Is that, you know, if you like the way a certain record sounds, you can go to the source and kind of those people that made those records, a lot of them are still alive, and they're happy to talk about it in most cases. That's what Dan did. He told me that himself. He went and he talked to the engineer that engineered James Brown records. He went and talked to the engineers that, you know, that worked at Muscle Shoals and stuff like that. He did that. He worked, you know, any chance he could, he would talk to the people that, you know, that were around when they were making records at Cosmos and when they were making records at Royal Studios, High Records, and all that stuff. He, you know, those sounds that we all kind of like fell in love with, he went the extra distance and tried to seek out the people who were there when they were making those records and ask them how they did it. Where did you put that microphone? Where did you, you know, what sort of tape delay is that? What sort of compression is that? What sort of microphone is that? You know, so anyway, makes total sense that you do. I mean, I did that with musicians. I would go and try to find older musicians who would show me things, but it never dawned on me that the engineers and the tech people behind the scenes might still be alive and might still want to talk about it and share that too. You know, as much as I was into the Beatles and how revolutionary their recording techniques were, and I knew about George Martin, for years it never really dawned on me that Jeff Emmerich was just as important, you know. As an engineer, he was the one who was actually doing a lot of that experimental stuff that made that sound so great, you know.
And you tend to, at least in my experience, the producers, the engineers often remember the specifics a bit better too, whether it's the years on the road or the drinking, drugging, or just age. I noticed like producers and engineers, you know, though they have firm, detailed recollections of the sessions, of the specifics. And so I can see how soaking up the game from them is a great education. And yeah, I just wanted to kind of, because, you know, I know producing is a big part of your bag, and I wanted to just kind of get the 411 on that as well. You've been super generous with your time. And like I said, we left a lot on the table. So hopefully down the road, we could do it again. But I want to say thank you. And at the end of every episode, I try to ask the artist to let us know what's next, either what's happening now, what can we look forward to, what's hot in the life of Papa Molly, wherever you want to like send people after they enjoyed this lovely conversation.
Okay. Like I say, I am really very much, I do like to talk. And so that's kind of obvious, but I don't really like to live in the past at all. I do like to keep moving forward, and that keeps me interested in what I'm doing. And hopefully I keep doing things that are interesting to other people too. But right now I'd say the things that I am really the most excited about are some singers that I've been working with, like one in particular, Lynn Drury. I've just produced her new album, and it's not out yet. And I'm just blown away by her as a songwriter, as a singer, as an artist. I think that she should be, you know, that I'm hoping that this record will be the one that kind of takes her to the next level, because she certainly paid her dues and deserves that. And this record is amazing. And I'm really proud of the production that we did on it. And everybody played so beautifully on it. But it's the songs, it's her songs that just blow me away. I think she's one of the great songwriters that's out there these days. And then another great singer songwriter that I didn't have anything to do with her album, but I'm so into it, and I've gotten to play a few shows with her lately, is Jen Howard. She's just this incredible singer, and her new album is amazing. And I suggest that everybody buy it and go listen to it. Ivan Neville is a guest on one song, but he'd be the first to tell you too, that it's like, her voice is the star of the show. She's an amazing singer.
Time to make up, I'll make sure you don't look fake. So what you mean is, see your weakness, there's a lot at stake. My mind is made up, but I'm fired up, come on, behave. Not time to fold up, come on, you come too far to cave. Two witches on, I got this microphone.
And a great songwriter too. So I just, nothing but good things to say about those two projects, which are those two of the things I'm staying very busy with right now.
That's awesome. And thanks for the tip on both of the Lynn and Jen. And I feel like there is a plethora, there's a revival of sorts of incredibly talented, unique female vocalists coming out of the Crescent City at this time. I'm not going to take any of the shine away from the two you put on.
Another one is Cole Williams, is another really great singer that's an artist and a humanitarian, and I really love everything she's doing. Also, I've been working with a singer out of Harlem, New York, named Carlton Jamel Smith. We just did a show at Tupatina's, and he is a real deal old school soul singer. He and I recorded a track with the Brand New Bag. We did some shows with Brand New Bag 2 weeks ago or 1 week ago. I can't remember, recently. And then we went in the studio while he was still in town and recorded a track that I wrote. So that's another thing I'm doing. It's like incredible. I'm just trying to keep diversified, trying to work with people that I enjoy working with, and just keep on putting out music, and hopefully folks will keep listening to it.
Yes, indeedy. As usual, I want to offer a deep bow and gratitude and huge thanks to Papa Molly. Malcolm, that was a very heart-filling, informative, illuminating, emotional, just an incredible musicology on your behalf. Thank you for taking us through your life, your career, your passions, your inspirations, your friends, peers, influences, geography, genre, Jamaica, New Orleans, and all points between. This is why I do this shit, fam. I learned so much. I've been a fan of Papa Molly from afar for like a long ass time. And to have that conversation with him, to get the 411 on how it all came together, just really, I love that shit. And I loved that conversation. So thank you, Papa Molly. And that's what we're trying to do around here at the Up for Life podcast, is deep exercises in musicology, influences, inspiration, overcoming adversity. And Papa Molly, you know, he laid it all out there. And he was really incredible reggae stuff. And oh man, I could just rehash the whole thing, but I just, you know, just going to nod and bow my head and just give thanks. We're listening to Oswald live from Cologne, Germany in 1980. One of my low-key favorite reggae bands of all time. I always give the crown to Black Uhuru, but Oswald is fucking incredible. So if you're curious, A-S-W-A-D, Oswald, from like the late 70s through the late 80s. Roots reggae style, very danceable. Pretty sure they're from the UK, but they have, you know, West Indian roots, like so many. And like we always do about this time, the Vibe Junkie Jam. I'm only going to play one jam this week, this ep. I always say this week. Maybe I should start putting out episodes on a weekly basis. Anyway, for the Vibe Junkie Jam on episode 70... I am going to play some music from the late, great Brad Houser, who Papa Molly spoke so beautifully about and told such just heart-filling, emotionally beautiful stories and reflections. So Papa Molly's actually not on this track, but Brad Houser is, prominently, I might add. It's from Critters Buggin', 1998 album called Bumpa. The first song, which is called Fluoride and is powered by Killin', Brad Houser bass line. I was thinking I had both Skerrick and Mike Dillon from Critters Buggin' on the pod. So this is still close to home, and I'm stoked. I've always loved this record and particularly this song. And when we're thinking about Brad and some of his lasting contributions, You gotta look towards Critters Buggin'. And Mike Dillon and Skerrick both shared voluminously about their friendship and the grief and the music that they made with Brad. And you know, before Russell Batiste passed, I would say that the outpouring of grief and sadness and also pride and love for Brad Houser was, you know, equally touching, moving. And when I spoke to Papa Mali, it was right on the heels of that. And then obviously in the interim month or so, I guess month and a half, Russell Batiste passed, and that's why I wanted to play something for Russell at the beginning of the episode. And I want to also encourage people to check out Stanton Moore and Adam Deitch's conversation about Russell Batiste on YouTube. I'm going to put the link in the show notes. I posted it on social, but basically it's two icons, Stanton and Adam Deitch, one New Orleans cat, one an adopted son of New Orleans, and in Adam, and they both just... Russell was still alive at this point. This is a year and a half ago. This conversation takes place as part of Stanton Moore Drum Academy, which is a subscription-based thing. But they put this 10 minutes of talking on YouTube, and about 7 of the 10 minutes is focused on Russell Batiste. So I was going to play that too, but I didn't want to necessarily encroach on Stanton's material and yada, yada, yada. So with respect to that, just check out the show notes, click the link, and you can listen to Stanton and Adam love on Russell Batiste. But from right here, right now, we're going to dive into Critters Buggin' Fluoride, 1998. Brad Houser, rest in peace. This is the end of the episode when I always like to sign off, say goodbye, God bless. Rest easy, Brad Houser and Russell Batiste Jr. A moment for all the death and destruction and confusion in Israel and Palestine. Love y'all. Thanks for tuning in. See you next time, which is going to be in like just a few days, because I'm doing back-to-backs, and the next one's a doozy too. Peace.
Sodium fluoride roach poison is a little clipping from the Wall Street Journal, 4/26/1990, and it says, "You may not like it, but it's true. The central nervous system of a human being bears some surprising similarities to that of a cockroach. If it kills a cockroach, it'll kill you too."
It's doing a wonderful job of that.
salicylic acid. The first use is to fluoridate the water. Its second use is to remove the hair and the gore from hides at the slaughterhouse. Sodium fluoride is the main ingredient. Og, squawk, and sarin nerve gas. This is this product used to fluoridate water with in the United States. Gives you a nice warm fuzzy feeling, doesn't it? Hydrofluorosilicic acid is the most corrosive chemical agent known to man. And we eat it every day. If a third world country did this to themselves, you'd laugh at them. Okay, right here, hot off the press. Bad, 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 noisy parents.
Thank you.